Let's kick it.
Hello and welcome to what's new in Windows Whistler Build 2410. Well, we're over the hump of Beta 1 and now firmly into the Beta 2 period. And I don't know if anybody actually gets to, or much less reads, the blue screens that I put at the end of each video, which have a bit of blurb in the middle, which I update for every video. But yeah, but in the last one, I mentioned how the thousands of improvements they mention in the setup screens, it seemed a bit of a stretch. I mean, it was a bit of an update over Windows 2000, but it wasn't that big of a difference really when it comes to it. But now for this build 2410, that's probably actually true. There's quite a lot of differences between this one and the last one, and they've been hard at work in both the UI and under the hood. So let's get into it. Obviously, first up, you can see straight away from the desktop that the theme, there's a new one. Well, there's two new ones, and they're obviously the sample test styles, and there's Blue Lagoon, which is this one, which is green, so I don't know why it's called Blue Lagoon, and there's Chatterer's Mongoose, which is pretty much exactly the same, except that it might not pick up on the video, but if you look, the middle of the dialog box changes colour here, so it's like orange coloured, and then it's blue, yeah. See, that's the only main bit of difference between these styles, unless you actually apply them and then you see that they're actually completely different. Well, not completely different, but the backgrounding of the tabs and the start menu, the gradient on the start menu change colour to orange instead of blue. But yeah, you'll also notice in it, if you enable it and you look at yours, it won't look like this one. No, and that's because I've enabled, and obviously, as I usually do, I've uncommented everything that was commented. But what I've also done is added a little bit which fixes these, I don't know what you'd call them, the text background bits on list views. And it gives it a nice curved edge on the left hand side there. Normally, if you just enable it, you'll just get a standard blue coloury one, or it'll just be three different colours smushed together. And indeed, I can show you that, what it would look like if you just enabled it, because I've retained the themes. You can see it also applies to the normal list views in Explorer, and it doesn't look quite as good there because it's too small. The actual entries in the lists are too small, so it doesn't go quite well. And they kept this pink as well for some reason, I don't know why they've kept this, well, magenta, not pink, and that's not really looking nice anymore. But yeah, onwards, you can see that they change colour when you hover and select them. What I'm after is resources. And in a test folder, and you can see I've got loads of different ones I've been playing with. First, I have to disable this, obviously, because it won't show up if I just change the file over, so let's set it to professional. Watercolour, whatever it's called now. I'll do. Then you get what I call the three stripes version, and you'll see why in a minute. And that is why, if you just uncomment everything in the theme, you'll get buttons that look like that. That's because these three are the backgrounds, which you'll get if you hover over them normally. If they were fixed, that's what you'd get. But the theme file has it set to only one background picture instead of three, so it smushes them all into the one thing, because it thinks there's only one picture instead of three. So what I did was fixed it and add the... I changed it to 3, and I added the transparency. You can add there's now a transparency thing in the theme files, and I set it to this magenta colour, and that's why you now get... Oh, I've got to try and read this now. Yeah, and that's where you get the rounded corners. That was the biggest part, wasn't it? Yeah, there you go, and it's back to being fixed. That's pretty much the difference when it comes to the themes. Except for one other thing. If you uncomment everything in the watercolour theme, then you won't see this because it's actually set, it's not commented, but it's set to false. So you won't actually see it. Whoa, where did that big button come from? Anyway, let's see if we can fix that. Nope, okay then. Yeah, what you'll get though is you won't get this in the corner, this user picture tile. Now you can enable it. There's a thing called user tile. It's down near the bottom of the theme file. I don't have them on hand. Why don't I just look at them? That'd help, wouldn't it? It's in this one, and it is in that one. If I go down to the bottom somewhere, you can. I want to just search for user picture. Panel.userpane here, it's the user picture entry, and that's by default set to false, but if you set it to true, then this appears in the corner, the user picture. Oop, was it? The user picture appears in the corner, and yeah. You may also notice that we've had some more look and feel changes, and they've mostly been all the icons which have been XP-ified. My computer, all these ones here, all that one is pretty much only network connections, which hasn't been XP-ified so far. I like this run icon. It looks like a picture I drew in primary school, where he's got the big macking leg at the back and the short leg at the front. So yeah, it reminds me of that, and yeah, it's quite whimsical. I don't know why they didn't keep that. It's quite fun. Anyway, another thing the start menu can now do, which it couldn't do before, is if you right click, you can now remove things from the list, and it disappears. And you also get this blurb which directs you to the wrong thing. It says, if you want to put the internet, email, or music and video shortcuts back, even though there wasn't a music and video shortcut, then it says right click the start menu button, properties, customize, advanced, and set it. So that's, let's do that and see how far we get. So right click, properties, customize, advanced, and yeah, that's not there. And it tells you to go to this page. It's actually on this page. You want to tick that one. I've looked with Spy++, there's no button here for a music and video option, so that's just redundant. And a preview of things to come at the moment, it's not implemented. Newness pervades the accessories that also come with Windows now. If we open Paint, you can now see, ignore the big macking, I think the big macking buttons are part of the theme. Shut up, you. But yeah, what you can do is, if you now go to save as, instead of just being able to save as a bitmap, you can now save as JPEG, GIF, Metafile, TIFF, and PNG. And that's because it's now Paint has now been fitted out with GDI Plus, which can do all those things. Windows Media Player's time in the sun has come and gone, as it's now been replaced on the quick launch bar by MSN Explorer, which we don't talk about, because the first rule of MSN Explorer is you don't talk about MSN Explorer. Also new in Windows is the support for, when I can actually click on things properly, there we go, is support for compressed folders and zip files. Now, I said in a previous video I didn't know why the ZF Center Target file extension was in the list of things that System Restore looks at, because it hadn't been like invented yet, but obviously it had been invented because it was in the plus packs for Windows 98 and Windows ME, the compressed files function. So it's new to the base Windows, but it's not new to Windows. And all I can say about it is that it's probably the worst coded piece in Windows, because it's an abominable, it's just abominable. whoever did the job of porting it from Dynazip's standalone thing, because it's licensed code from Dynazip, whoever ported it from their standalone program to a shell extension did a extremely bad job of it, which means it's not usable, except in very specific circumstances, by programs which never exit, which is pretty much what Explorer and only Explorer. So yeah, you can't use the standard folder interfaces, but that's a rant for a different time. So yeah, it actually does actually work. Ooh, selection doesn't know. Ooh, that's funny. Oh, delayed it. Delayed selection. So yeah, you can send things to the folder. Unlike what you get in Final Windows, it doesn't actually show the file and let you rename it. It doesn't actually show the file at all, unless you scroll all the way down to the bottom, because that's where it comes out. But yeah, it does work, so it's zip files. Explorer gets even more new functionality in 2416 with the use of all these new Explorer bars. Well, there's not that many there, but when the full list is there, there's actually quite a lot of them. One of the more interesting ones is the media bar, which tries to connect to somewhere on the Windows Media website, which doesn't exist anymore, so that fails. But one of the interesting part is down here you can select, well, you can go to my music and it will not do anything. Yeah, what you can do is open and then it lets you select an audio or video file. So if I use one of the ones I've got, and they're going to be in, I don't know, where are they? There we go, I'll try this one. Is that the one that worked? I can't remember. That can't be the one that worked. Anyway, what you can do is, if you select it, it lets you watch or listen to whatever you're doing in Explorer, just there. Well, yes, it does work. Yeah, so you can continue doing that while you're watching things in Explorer. It also plays music as well, so you can play music and listen to that while you're doing things in Explorer. So it's just a little nifty sort of embedded Windows media player in Explorer. And, you know, I think that's quite funky. It might be a bit unnecessary because you can just open Windows Media Player, but since they've pretty much hidden that from view by default, it's a good place to stick it. So it's more in your face. Yes, there you go. Here, there's quite a few more altogether. There's the contacts one, which is pretty much Outlook Express in here, and you can send emails and instant messages and stuff like that. So there's quite a lot of new functionality with the Explorer bars, and it doesn't end there. If you open up Internet Explorer, then all these new Explorer bars are also here on the left side of the window, and you can do exactly the same thing in Internet Explorer. So you can open media and play music while you're looking at websites and stuff like that. There's also two, you can open up MSN Messenger, you can get a free passport. Oh, hey, that's me off to Sweden. Yeah, it's not quite, it's not brilliant, but you know, I quite like this. I don't know why, I don't know why they got rid of it, because, you know, you don't need it there and in Explorer, and pretty much all the other stuff is better served in its standalone applications than it is in one, like, all-in-one application. But I don't know, I quite like this being here, and yeah. Explorer's new goodies don't end there, though. If you try and open a file which has no registered handler, like this I don't know file here, then you get a new Windows cannot open file dialog, and it tells you what you're trying to open, and as you might have seen there, it tells you the type and then it says downloading. Now that's because it's trying to look at a web service to get a friendly name for the file. So if this was an ISO file, for instance, then it might say disk image. But anyway, if it doesn't find it, it disappears, because there's no point saying unknown, because it's obvious it's unknown, because this is the unknown file type dialog. So yeah, what it does, if we look at Wireshark, is that it actually goes out and has a stab at looking for a computer called Brian ST. Now, you probably don't have a computer called Brian ST on your network, unless your name is Brian Stevenson and you're very vain. But what you can do is start a computer, which is called Brian ST, and there's absolutely no correlation to Brian Stevenson. And we'll give that a bit of time to start up. And there it is, up and running. So now if I open this again, then you see it went off a bit quicker at that time. And you can see now here that it went looking for this URL on the computer, filosoc/filosoc.asp with the lang ID and the extension there. Obviously that doesn't exist on the computer and I'm not creating that because I don't know the format of it for a start off. So yeah, anyway, what that would, obviously that's not there, so it doesn't show up here. But you could do, if you were at Microsoft, you could go to auto lookup and that would probably take you to where the actual extension program that handled the extension lived, because as you can see here it looks for brianst/filosoc/langid/xml/reader.asp, so that'd probably, like I say, take you to where the software was hosted. Yeah, so that's it. You can also select from this, which gets you back to an updated version of the old Dialog, open with Dialog, which you can also click here to up select a file, as you could do anyway. So yeah, that's that. That is new. Yep, it turns out there's a little story about this Brian ST computer on Raymond Chen's blog. It's entitled The Day Shell.Windows.com Went Down. I'll put a link to it in the video description, but as you can pretty much see here, it was, when it was being developed, the programmer just scrabbled around for an old unused computer and put it on there. And that's what they used to test it, and it kept going and it kept going until about RC1, and then it went offline and they didn't know why. And then they plugged it back in and it worked, and then they fixed it and sent it to somewhere where it wouldn't just be in some guy's office. So that's the story behind it. But anyway, I scrounged around and found the programmer responsible, which he mentions, and it turns out to be this dude, Mr. Brian Starbuck. So as you can see, he was a bit vain by calling it Brian ST, but there you go. And yeah, I googled his name and he has actually worked for Microsoft, so this is actually the dude. I wouldn't recommend tweeting him because, you know, he don't want 500 people. Yeah, 500 looking at these videos, yeah. He don't want 5 people actually sending him tweets about stuff that's long in the past. And I haven't bothered sending him a tweet either because there's pretty much no need. So that's the dude responsible for it. And that's the new unknown file dialog. Away from Explorer, and some new functionality was added to the disk cleanup manager thing. This thing, you know what it is. Yeah, disk cleanup. And if you go to more options, it can now clean up system restore points. And it does seem to work. Here's a quick whiz around some things that don't need much explanation. First up, there's now there's now metadata for video files in Explorer. On the display properties thing, the Energy Star logo has disappeared, and the blank screensaver is now called, well, it's now called the blank screensaver instead of the default screensaver. This Energy Star monitor does still exist in the resources. It didn't used to look like that, because that's not, but it does look like that now. It's not, it's been changed, the number of it has been changed, which is why it's not there. It's got a pink background and it looks slightly more lower res or higher res, I can't remember how the last one looked. But anyway, yeah, these bars though, they've disappeared. They're no longer on the settings tab for the low display resolution, for the low colour settings. It's now just the high colour one pretty much all the way through. Yep. There's also on Explorer folders, there's now a customise this folder option, so you don't actually have to go to properties and customise when the mouse stops acting up. And also the customized dialog has also changed. It now lets you select which type of files you want in it and how you want to arrange them. And also you can create a thumbnail folder or do it yourself or change the icon to select from all the icons. And There's also a new tab in this computer system properties under advanced, and if you go to settings of visual performance, then there's now this visual effects tab, and you can select and disable the individual elements of the animations that Windows and Windows now provides, and all the other things like mouse shadows and stuff like that. Also, in a case of we don't know what to call it, in the control panel you can see, when I look at it, that it's now the thing that manages your network passwords is now called the keyring again, as it was in Neptune, no longer the credential manager. It's still the same old thing though, so no changes there. But yep, they've changed the name of it. Also, another change is that the manifests format has changed, and it's now the final manifest format. So your things from, well, your XP manifested programs will now work without having to be changed. And as you can see, well, I showed you it before, didn't I? The changes in the manifest, so I won't go through all that again. But yeah, now it's got the full XML type file in it, and they work just fine, so no need for your old nobbled manifests anymore, because they're not needed anymore. Also, that's been updated is the publish this file to the web dialog. We still got the first bit with no tutorial button anymore, and that still doesn't fit. But nevertheless, we now have three different things. We have the original MSN communities, with the one with the broken redirect. We have the other, which lets you type in whatever you want. And now we've got this new one, MSN communities tweener / WinINet testbed site. If you select it, you'll see that it doesn't work. Now I still have Wireshark running, so we can see where it was going to look, and you can see that it doesn't actually go into look anywhere. It's just nothing. It doesn't work. I can tell you where it's going now, because thanks to this, we can have a look in NetPLWiz, because all these providers now have a XML file talking about them in the resources. Now, it's just an XML file, but we can see down the right side here, and it's this one here. It's looking for, well, it should have shown up, it's looking for zancart_1.dns.microsoft.com/winwiz. Now obviously, even if it showed up in Wireshark and it tried connecting to there, it wouldn't work, because this site doesn't exist anymore. You can, well, I can't try it because I don't think it will show up, but no, I don't think it's going to work. Nah, it's not working. Anyway, so yeah, it doesn't quite work, but that's where it would actually send the request to, and I don't know how that would work. There's also one down here at the bottom, which I don't know how to get to display in the UI, but it's called Other. No, not Other, that's the thingy one. There's one down here. Provider for the photo printing wizard. And it says internet photo printing, so I'm not, that's probably why it's not showing up on this one, but I don't know how to make it show up. Anyway, it's the Windows photo printing site it was sent it to, and this is at an internal Microsoft site called Windows client / UX / publish / IPP / IPP _ intro. Now, and it says the description is example of a photo printing site to test the concept. Also in 2014 and not 2016, as I said earlier, is everybody's favourite completely non-annoying feature. And what do I mean by that? That was new to Windows XP anyway. I mean the desktop cleanup wizard. That thing that popped up every like 5 minutes saying, oh, you've got unused icons on your desktop, do you want to get rid of them? And it obviously got on everybody's nerves, and it's meant to run every 60 days at this point, but it seems like it runs every 2 seconds on your computer. Anyway, you can run the wizard, and it's now like this. I don't think, I think it looked like this in XP, didn't it? I don't know, I never really used it. So yeah. Yep, we got this problem with icons again, so it's either come back or it's only affecting certain icons. So yeah, I'm not gonna do any of them. Actually, go on, I will do. I'll stick that. That's not even on the desktop. Where's that come from? Oh, that's weird, isn't it? There's no Internet Explorer on the desktop, and yet it's listed in there. Along with... is there any more? Oh, it's just that one. Oh, that's weird. Where's that come from? Anyway, let's click it, see what happens. Whoa, hang on, that's only the other ones as well. Leave those, who knows when I might want to file a bug report against this. And that seems to have... oh, well, we've got one here, and it has... ooh. Oh, that's... not... that's weird. It doesn't seem to have an icon. The icon is a white square. Oh, that's weird. Oh well. And that's going to just about do it for part 1 of build 2410. If you are so inclined, you can watch part 2 of this by clicking on watch part 2, because there is indeed a part 2 to go with this part 1, because it would look a bit silly having a part 1 without a part 2. As for what's in it, I don't know yet because I haven't recorded it, but I have found the stuff, I just can't remember what's in it. So come and join me to solve the mystery.